ready for another chapter of Don't Feed the Bully? Our last chapter was very long and very entertaining, might I add. The whole thing about Mr. Crumblebean threw me off, and I could not believe they called an ambulance because Ralphie stuck a tater tot in a ventriloquist dummy. That's hilarious. I wonder what Handy's gonna do about all of this. What do you think his plan is? Maybe we'll learn a little bit of his plan in Chapter 8. Are you ready? Chapter 8. I dropped my complaint into the AAS box first thing Monday morning. I need at least 3 days preparation before I could put any plan into action. The complaint took 3 hours of tweaking to get it just the way I wanted. It had to sound sincere, but also be an obvious challenge to Kurt. Mine said that I was ready to take Kurt on in his own arena and play his game because this note was going to bring his fight to me. I had to be ready to adjust to whatever Mr. Pesterman and his society had to dish out. My dad asked me what I was working on, and it might surprise most kids to know I told him the entire story. I figured my parents needed to know the possibilities of harm to my academic career, and they might need to be prepared to take a personal day or two off from work to listen to the principal speak unkindly about their precious boy detective. I had no idea how devious or dirty Kurt would play. Dad's response, "We trust you, sport, and we will be there for you." I had an epiphany. When it came to parents, I was as lucky as Mowgli from Jungle Book. Jungle Book 2, that is, not the first Jungle Book. Although, who would want money to be raised by wolves for a while? Dad also told me to consider the consequences and asked if I wanted him and Mom to talk to my teacher. "Yes and no," I said. "Okay, sport," he said. "Decide, though, if the problems you can cause for yourself are worth the good you can accomplish." "Can't help it, Dad," I said as I looked into his knowing eyes. I worried for a second that he was going to hug me, but he faked the hug, grabbed the Nerf ball, and put up a three-pointer from the doorway, nothing but net. I waited as long as I could, near but out of sight from the complaint box for Kurt or someone to pick up the note. No one came. I walked into the homeroom, wondering how long I'd have to wait for my bitter little pill to give Kurt a stomachache. Already, the waiting wasn't doing anything for my appetite. Bully victims often have the same feelings. The time you spend worrying about the couple of minutes a day you have to spend crossing the bully's path makes your nerves a wreck for hours or days. I wasn't crazed with anticipation, but I do prefer the action to begin rather than wait. I didn't wait long. Kirk walked in and eyeballed me harder than a copper to a kleptomaniac. I pulled my lips back in a smile so tight oxygen atoms had to knock on my mouth to enter and let me breathe. Kurt strolled by the other students, who either physically or mentally moved away from him like a pit viper in a cuddly bunny's burrow. "Mr. Greatneck," Kurt said as he slithered up, "it seems we have a problem." "Oh, good, you got my note," I said, innocent as a peach fuzz on a baby's forehead. "No," Kurt said, looking up and right, "I didn't get a note." This was lying. "I've been hearing rumors that you are harassing some of the smaller fourth graders," he said. "Weak ruse, Pesterman," I said calmly and politely, knowing Kurt would know what a ruse was. "You have no complaints about me, and I'm spotless. You run to the teachers with this garbage, and they will laugh you out of your goofy plaid pants. Even if you get a fourth grader to lie, and you can't, I can prove I haven't been around them enough to make threats. Furthermore," I said, making sure my voice was still as friendly as Mr. Rogers on Good Neighbor Day, "I've already made friends with 80% of the school. They might be scared of you, but they won't lie for you, and your thugs crying bully will sound a tad hollow since I'm half their size." Kurt stood and mulled over my words. He also seemed to be waiting for something. He knew his threats were useless, but he was letting me know the game had begun and waiting for some sort of signal. His sign received, he went into action. I had to move quickly or lose round one. "Well, Greatneck," Kurt said as he looked over my shoulder toward the door for the seventh time, "you may be right about that, so I guess I need to take matters into my own hands." Kurt had positioned himself uncomfortably close to me between the desks while we talked. Before I could pull myself away from the stench of his Pop-Tart breath, he jumped backwards over the desk and threw all of his books into the air. The scream that came from his mouth as he fell tore through the classroom like ice-pick sharp nails on a blackboard. I knew Kirk's play in an instant. I had about 3 seconds to mount my counterattack. Glancing over my shoulder, I saw what Kurt was waiting to happen. He had timed his move perfectly. He flipped like a rag doll seconds after Mrs. Austin came in the room. Worst shit for me, Ralphie lumbered in a few seconds before Mrs. Austin. The whole class was watching him and could not verify Kurt's Olympic vault over the desk. Kurt wanted to be my word against his, and he knew most calls go to the home team. Luckily, Kurt wasn't playing the B team today, but reigning state champs. As he fell, I went into action. I ran around his falling floor and slammed my books on the bookshelf below the window, thanking fate that it was a warm day and the window was open. The movement of my books startled everyone more than Kurt's wounded baby lamb cries. The room and even Kurt went silent. "Boys, what's going on over there?" Mrs. Austin asked. Kurt's lip began to quiver like jello in an earthquake. Great neck just pushed me over the desk," he said, looking around the room for sympathy. There was none to be had from his classmates as the song had dropped off the charts. Everyone backed away to what seemed like a safe distance from any loose involvement that might still be flying around the room. "Is this true, Hannibal?" Mrs. Austin asked, looking perplexed and disappointed. I let the accusation hang in the air like the sheet when Mom flaps it over the bed and it floats down over the mattress. The sheet was not coming down to smother me. "Yes," I said, and if a word could steal the power of speech from an entire room, I found the word. Mrs. Austin looked surprised. Kurt went pale. He'd expected me to start stammering, trying to deny his fake title. Then he could use his credibility to force the issue, call me a liar, and bring a great deal of suspicion my way. Denial always looked guilty. "You did push, Kurt?" Mrs. Austin asked, stuck in a time warp. "Yes," I repeated, "and way harder than I intended." "You wanted to push him, then?" Mrs. Austin asked. She was getting this picture slower than if I were skywriting it. "That wasp was huge," I said, "and with Kurt allergic to the bee stings, I figured I need to get him out of the way fast. I didn't mean to push him that hard, though. Are you okay, Kurt?" My mock sincerity was first rate. Kurt was speechless. His mouth gaped open like a small bass in a Chinese restaurant pond. Mrs. Austin's brain finally joined the party. She said, "Oh, that's why you hate your books on the shelf." Kurt tried to recover, but it was too late. "But he said he was sick of me." This recovery was too little too late. "Why would I say me, Kurt?" I said, looking at Kurt as if he were a silly pants. "I said bee, although actually it was a wasp." I picked up my books, and there was, of course, no wasp. "Looks like it flew out the window," I said. Well, it's a good thing you were here, Handy," said Mrs. Austin. I was handy again. Kurt lost this round, and he gave up like a 4-pound fish on a 100-pound test line. "Yeah, I guess," he said with the sincerity of a wicked stepmother. "A little fall is better than swelling up like a balloon. Right, Kurt?" said Mrs. Austin. "Thank you," Kurt said through vice-like clenched teeth. He paused and said the next word as if he were swallowing a booger sandwich. "Handy." I could see that hurt, and I know this was just the beginning. The commotion waning, we all moved to our seats, and Kurt picked up his books as no one felt like helping. As I walked by the cage, Ralphie asked, "How did you know Kurt was allergic to bee stings?" "How could he not be?" I said. "And I was in the nurse's office for lice check and saw an EpiPen with his name on it. Detectives should notice everything." "What do you write with that?" Ralphie asked. I was going to explain that an EpiPen was not a pen. It was an emergency shot that anyone who has severe allergies needs to have on hand at all times in case they are, for example, stung by a bee. But I couldn't be seen lording around Ralphie's cage, so I just said, "Epiphanies, Ralphie. I used to write an epiphany. I love that. And there's the end of chapter 8, my friends. What did you think about Handy's plan? got the note, he's like, what note? So he never got the note. What do you think is in the note that he left for the Agitator Awareness Society? Or did he get the note and he was just acting like he hadn't got the note? Oh my goodness, there's so many possibilities. How do you think that would have turned out if Candy hadn't have acted quick enough? Would Ralphie have gotten in trouble? Would Handy gotten in really big trouble? How was Kurt going to play that off, I wonder? What do you think is going to happen next? Because now, Candy just one-upped Kurt, and now Kurt's probably going to be really mad. What do you think is going to happen? Oh my goodness, there's so many questions and not enough answers yet. I hope you're all doing good and you're staying safe and you're washing your hands. And hopefully you'll join me for our next chapter.